This month's Where Did the Road Go is sponsored by six awesome individuals: Billuminati, Allison Cook, Super Inframan, 36 Dingo, Lindsay Trebet, and Michael Fritchie. If you want to become a patron, go to wheredidtheroadgo.com. Thank all of you for your generous support and enjoy the show.
Transmission start. Welcome to Where Did the Road Go? Join us as we wander off the path and explore lost history, consciousness, the paranormal, unexplained mysteries, alternative thought, and much more. We are present on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com. Now here is your host, Seriah.
Welcome to this edition of Where Did the Road Go? And tonight I have with me Mr. Travis Watson.
Hello, hello.
Wren Collier.
Hey, everyone.
And Vincent Treewell.
Hey, glad to be here.
So, Travis, you're in the midst of writing your next book.
Oh, yes.
And how is that coming?
I'm up to my armpits in alligators, and I'm down the rabbit hole completely. I just spent a little quality time this evening with GNM Chiral's Apparitions book. Colin Wilson and I have gotten to be good friends in the past couple of months. And, discovered some writings about poltergeists and Rupert Matthews and so forth. And tying that all together with our favorite hairy monster has been quite the ride. So I've been having a good time with that. It's just, it's not going as fast as I would like, but they never do.
I feel that, like, with all this stuff, everything really is related to poltergeists.
Well, poltergeist apparitions, you know, haunting stuff, there's all kinds of crazy things that you can tie in so much of this Class B Sasquatch stuff into. The signs that people take as the presence of a Sasquatch when they haven't actually seen it. It boggles my mind. Yeah. I mean, I knew in a sort of a general way that, you know, that I totally agreed with what you said, that if we took all this stuff that people were attributing to Sasquatch and stuck it into a house, it would be a poltergeist case.
Right.
And I had no idea, you know, after reading, Enfield, and after reading the Black Monk Pontefract case, and, Olive Hill out of William Roll's book, there's all of this great information that ties so neatly into a lot of the stuff that people are seeing out in the woods.
Yeah.
The only difference is that you have a definite kind of a different flavor, I guess, with your wilderness poltergeist as opposed to your house poltergeist.
Right. Yeah.
But for instance, you know, you're talking about vocalizations, and I don't want to, you know, go down the rabbit hole and leave everybody else, you know, kind of sitting here, but, you're talking about vocalization. I was just reading tarot today. It's one of the classics of psychical research, right? Talks about one of the landmarks of Sasquatch stuff is vocalizations, right? He talks about a ghost experience, an apparitional experience that a landowner had after his tenant committed suicide, where he was aware of a presence outside of his house and he heard a scream that was so loud that it literally, you know, I mean, it shook him to his very core. He describes being just, you know, practically wetting himself.
Huh.
The really interesting thing about this scream, though, is that his wife was sitting feet away from him and heard nothing.
Oh,
wow.
You go on and on. And, you know, again, you know, I don't want to monopolize the conversation, but there's just so much truth to this concept of there being this energy, whatever you want to call it, out there that's responsible for some of this stuff.
And
in Ireland, it'd be a banshee.
Right.
Could be. In Ireland, you know, typically it would just be the she, period.
Yeah.
But the guy, go ahead.
I was going to say, the guy hearing the sound and his wife not hearing it makes me think of the stories of people seeing lights that you can only see from one perspective. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, yeah, you can exactly. only hear it from one perspective.
Yeah. You can only hear it the one person and not the other. Or, you know, there's stories, Sasquatch stories, where one person sees one thing and one person sees something else.
Right. Right.
Yeah. One person sees a dark, you know, sort of squat, you know, shaggy figure, and the other person sees one that's practically white, but it's dirty, and they're in the same place.
Yeah.
In the one and only sighting that I actually had, that happened. And fortunately, my wife was there and saw something too, but we saw somewhat different things.
Right.
So, I mean, that's a thing that happened. It's bizarre, but it happened.
So what's your take on that? Why do you think that is? Is it?
I don't know. Maybe my mind couldn't handle seeing what she saw. She saw a Sasquatch, a, you know, pretty classic Bigfoot creature. And I saw a weird looking bear. And maybe this wasn't a scary encounter. This happened exactly once. But we did both see something huge, but it was running away from us. And we only saw it for a few seconds. And, you know, it was not traumatizing or terrifying. Now, if had it been coming at us, it would be a different story.
Yeah.
But I did not see a primate. She did. And she described it as looking like the one of the characters in the current version of the Planet of the Apes. But very definitely a primate. And I saw a bear, but not any kind of bear that actually exists, because it was huge and it was multicolored. And that really isn't, you know, there's no bear that matches that description.
Was it bipedal?
No. Well, that's the funny thing. It was going up a very steep hill.
Oh, okay.
And so it was like struggling to get, it was kind of hopping up the hill. It looked like it ordinarily walks upright, but it had to get on all fours to kind of hop its way up this quite steep embankment and get into the wooded area.
Right.
Yeah, so it seemed like it was
trying to get out of sight.
Yeah.
Yes,
like
exactly.
What a person will do when we're going up a really, really steep angle.
Exactly.
So yeah. Interesting.
and it could be that neither of you saw what was actually there.
And that's true. I'm just glad she saw something too.
Right.
So I just wasn't losing my mind, you know?
Yeah, you know, you have that situation, I think, where, you know, you're perceiving something and your mind is trying to attach some meaning to it. It's almost like a spirit communication, you know, where mediums describe, you know, they get these communications, but it takes, you know, it basically gets translated through their, you know, their brain, their thought processes, their experience, you know, and, you know, your experience may just not have been capable of coping with a Sasquatch, you know?
Yeah,
or your brain may just not have translated it that way. You know, you may have perceived a particular energy and your brain translated it one way and your wife's brain translated another way.
Yes. I wonder what, like, if there'd been a camera running, what it would have picked up, if anything. You know?
Yeah.
Or if it would have just stopped working.
That would be interesting. Yeah. It would shut down.
Unlike Soraya, I don't have one of those cameras in my car. I probably should, but yeah. It'd be interesting to see what popped up.
Yeah, those are very useful.
It'd undoubtedly be blurry.
I've read some stories where I really wish that the person had a dash cam.
Yeah. Although I don't think I've caught anything paranormal on it. But it's still interesting, nonetheless, sometimes to be like, what was that?
Well, you had that weird Man in Black type
That's
of
true.
Thing.
There was, yeah, there was that thing.
Which is weird primarily because, like, it could be a real guy just riding a bicycle or whatever.
Yes.
But
yeah.
Didn't you see him in a dream before you saw him in reality?
Yes.
Yes. That's the weird part.
Okay, so you have to tell the story now, sir.
I don't remember it enough. Because that connected also to a dream Natalie had. But there was a guy riding a scooter going toward Ithaca, and he was leaving ghosts behind or something like that. And I've never seen anyone on a scooter in Ithaca, like ever. And it was October, but it was still really hot out. And so as I was driving to Ithaca, there's this guy completely bundled up in like a sweatshirt and a hood and everything else on a scooter on the side of the road. And so I drove by and went, dude, in a scooter. What the hell?
Looking kind of like the Grim Reaper. Is that right?
Yeah, a little bit. Because you couldn't see his face or anything. And it was October, but it was still hot out. It was still like 90 degrees out. There's no reason anyone should be wearing that much clothes when it's 90 degrees out. And it was probably just some normal guy, but like I've never seen a scooter since.
Well, and I've mentioned, I don't know if I've mentioned it on this show, but I've mentioned my similarly weird experience with an overdressed, way overdressed human being. That it was on July 4th. I remember that because it was the 4th of July and we celebrated hanging out with the neighbors. And this man comes walking down. It was so hot. It was over 100 degrees. It was so hot that I was wearing shorts, and I never wear shorts. So I had to dig up an old pair of swim trunks. This was extremely hot. And a lot of the young guys that are walking down the street aren't even wearing shirts, okay?
Right.
We're in the city. Yeah, they're just nobody. It's really hot. And then out of nowhere, we're just sitting on the porch drinking a couple beers. And out of nowhere, this person comes walking down the street. And he's more like marching. He's like on a mission. And he's tall and broad. A black guy. He looked kind of like the late actor William Clark Duncan. Like he's a big dude, and he's wearing this black military style fatigues and combat boots and a full length leather coat. And it's like, how is this person even like not passing out?
Right.
And I'm like, my first thought is, oh my God, he's got to have a assault rifle or a shotgun under that coat, because why would you wear this in this climate?
Right.
He pays absolutely no attention to us, just walks right past looking straight ahead. And we just watch him walk past and he just walks until we can't see him anymore. Now, we lived in that area for quite a while, and we kind of, if I didn't know their name, I at least knew who, I saw them regularly. It's very residential.
Right.
Never saw him before, never saw him again. Like, what the hell was that? I told my wife, we just saw a Terminator, okay? that was my first explanation. It was crazy. It's like, it's not paranormal. I mean, a person could dress up like that and walk around, but what the hell? It's still weird.
It's like out of place people.
Yes. You know, the question is not could they, but why would they?
Right.
Yeah.
You know, on the subject of whether or not a camera would pick this stuff up, I honestly think that it wouldn't. And the reason I think this, I'm just going to read a real quick thing from Agrippa's three books, Book Called Philosophy, Book 3, Chapter 19, on the bodies of demons. And on the subject of the bodies of demons, the greatest and most recent theologians differ with philosophers. Indeed, Thomas affirms that all angels and evil demons are incorporeal, yet sometimes take bodies, which they soon leave. Dionysius steadfastly affirms in Divine Names that angels are incorporeal, yet Augustine and On Genesis thus asserted airy and fiery demons are said to be animals, because they thrive with the nature of airy bodies. They do not decay by death, because that element which prevails in them is more appropriate for acting than submitting. So the idea is that these entities or spirits aren't really like made of matter, right? Matter that can be photographed, you know, in any way. Like they can be perceived, but they exist in a sort of spiritual realm that a camera doesn't have like access to.
Mm.
He goes on here to talk, though, about how certain spirits do have like some, they can be interacted with physically. Like, however, the Platonist and Christian Sallust did not think that the nature of demons are without bodies, yet he claimed that the bodies of angels and demons are not the same. Indeed, his claim was that the angels are bodies of angels are all free from matter, while demon bodies are material in a certain way. He asserted that the bodies of demons are like those of shades, and they would be like the human dead. They are subject to passions, and they feel pain when they are struck or burned by fire into visible ashes, a phenomenon recorded at lengths in Tuscany. Although the body of a demon is a spiritual body, it is capable of great sensation and can be touched. Although this body may be cut, it comes together again and is restored like air and water. Yet at the same time, it is hurt. Hence, demons fear the sharpness of iron, spears, and swords. Thus in Virgil, the disciple said to Aeneas, "Now go on your way and unsheathe your sword." But yeah, the idea that it's almost like I was talking to somebody about this, say they're not, how it reminds me a lot of Keel in the ultraterrestrial thing. This idea that you've got these entities that, for whatever reason, exist outside of our reality, but can inhabit our reality by taking on like ad hoc created bodies, right? Or like taking raw matter from our world and inhabiting it for a short period of time until whatever energy powers that wears out and they fall apart.
Or they just choose to step back between.
Choose to go back too. They disconnect.
I mean, that's similar to my theory that the reason so much of this stuff smells like sulfur is that it's a temporary construct that starts decaying immediately.
Yeah, the sulfur could be an actual chemical byproduct of that transmutation process.
Yeah,
Josh Cutchin would probably agree with you on that one.
Well, I think it was his book that made me think about that, because if these, you know, because you see so many paranormal entities that just disappear, you know, Sasquatch, whatever. Yeah. Any monsters, they tend to just stop existing. And when he wrote the book on smells and he said sulfur is the most common smell and it's the smell of decay, I was like, well, that would make sense if these things were somehow temporarily created and immediately just start decaying rapidly and then they disappear. They can only sustain for so long.
Fascinating theory, yes.
I've been having a good time with the whole concept of, you know, okay, so we're talking poltergeists, right? It's like there's all kinds of records of you know, ghosts and poltergeists and so forth leaving tracks.
Yeah.
You know? It's like, okay. It's another one of those things that juxtaposes together to make you think twice about what people are experiencing out in the woods, you know?
Yeah.
I was just listening to Timothy, scratches left on bruises
or that sort of thing.
I was just listening to Timothy Renner today talk about the old-fashioned ghost hunting where they spread flour or dust on the floor and picked up footprints. And so, but somehow they leave tracks.
Yeah, and the Hans Holzer has a story in his book Ghosts, which is this massive compendium of his case studies, where that's exactly what happened. Family was experiencing a haunting. In particular, they were hearing the sounds of basically the pitter-patter of little feet upstairs. After considerable time, the wife decided that she was going to put down flour in one of the areas where they heard this all the time, just to prove to herself that there was something going on. She's, you know, I mean, because, you know, a lot of times when people are dealing with these invisible entities, whatever they are, they're going crazy. So put down flour. Long and short of it is there actually were small childlike tracks found in the flour after she did this. So, yeah, I mean, it happens. I've read in other, you know, ghost hunting blogs and things about people doing that back in the day before we got all advanced and technological and
I think they even
infrared and all that crap.
I think they even used that on some of the ghost hunting shows early on.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. They tried to well, I mean, you know, ghost hunting derives from the psychical research stuff. Yeah. So, yeah, you know, if they had any acquaintance at all with the old style ghost hunters, I know that's one of the things that they used to do. So,
yeah. I'm not sure how much our modern technology actually helps with this stuff.
Yeah, I've been watching. I don't have access to some of the more popular shows because up here in Canada, it's a little harder to get them. I'd have to do a VPN and you know, fake being in North America or being in the United States to be able to subscribe to some of those channels. But some of the things that I watch on YouTube and stuff, it's like, you know, we have all these pods and cameras and laser grids and all this stuff.
Yeah.
And you're basically talking about a being that's incorporeal. I'm just not sure, you know, how much good that does, you know, how much of the readings that people are getting are actually ghosts and not some fly that flew through the grid or something.
Yeah.
I
will say.
I gotta say, you probably haven't missed much, to be very honest.
Yeah.
The
two elements, technological elements, I think that are pretty useful, even still, are like, I like spirit boxes. I don't think that they're necessarily ghost hunting equipment, but more spirit communication equipment. Like, I've used them in ritual setting to speak with spirits that I've conjured. which works really well. But also, like, a temperature, using temperature as a gauge for the presence of a spirit, I think is still pretty reliable, because that goes back even to, you know, like a ceremonial sort of magic and evocation. Like, looking for temperature changes in the room is one of the signs that you know, like, that you've conjured the spirit properly.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I absolutely agree with that. And, you know, it's just, I think that a lot of these shows have just gone completely overboard, though.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I guess, and and taken the human element out of, you know, trying to find these spirits.
They need eyeballs, and so they're going to, you know, do the most outrageous things possible to get attention.
Right.
And sure, we make for good scientific inquiry.
I'm unsure how I feel about spirit boxes, but the thing that really blew my mind is when people were using, I think we saw them when we were in Gettysburg, and then I saw them somewhere else too, where were calling them portal boxes. And basically they were the spirit box thing, but put through a reverb pedal with a lot of black lights on the box. And I'm just like, this is even more useless than a spirit box as far as I'm concerned, because now you're getting, you know, what could be communication now distorted through the pedal. But boy, does it sound creepy.
Yeah, you know, you could probably make a good drone metal album that way.
Exactly.
I had a quick follow-up question for Wren. Reference what you were saying about demons and bodies. How would that relate to what I've just, you know, heard countless times, that demons wish to possess people so that they can experience the physical experiences, enjoy the lust of the flesh? Are there different kinds of demons? Are there those that need to get into a body? Or are there, you know, are there different types? Or how does that work?
Well, the demons I was referring to in that passage are the in the Greek sense, the D-A-E-N. M-O-N, which is just pronounced demon. A lot of people like to say daemon or whatever, but it's just demon as well. And I don't know. I mean, possession is a tricky topic, because I don't think it's, like, impossible. Like, you know, there's definitely accounts of possession in the Bible. Like, the whole point of exorcism, in both in Christianity and in multiple other, like, esoteric traditions, is to remove a spirit from someone. So I do think it's possible, but motivation-wise, I really don't know. I mean, I've speculated in the past that one of the reasons spirits like offerings is because it's like allowing them to experience things that they might have found pleasurable as a human. So, like, offering a spirit rum, you know, allows it to taste alcohol, or that's why things, like, it's usually like things that are vices that are offered, right? So fat and meats and cigars and tobacco and rum, you know, it's like things that people would have enjoyed in life. And
I guess I was thinking less of the involuntary possession, which I think is often, very often, mental illness. Yeah. And, you know, that's a whole different topic. But I was thinking of the voluntary possession, like where people, I'll be blunt, like in Voodoo, where they let the spirit enter them and, as they say, ride them. And that what the spirit enjoys that, because it gets to have a body again and hungry ghosts.
I mean,
so
you could speculate that. Yeah. I mean, personally, I don't have much experience with ATRs or Voodoo or anything, so I won't try to speak at length on it. It's just not like an area that I have a lot of expertise in. I've definitely heard stories like that, but it's also hard for me to separate the reality of it, which is a lot of times hidden behind an initiatory tradition that isn't publicly known. And, you know, probably sensationalized accounts by ethnologists and anthropologists and tabloids. So it's difficult for me to parse it, really, but I certainly think it's something that's possible. I just don't know enough about it to really comment one way or the other.
Yeah, I get you. I was also just thinking of the idea that, like, vampires were corpses that were inhabited by a demon and made to walk around and do stuff. And, you know, that's been a fascinating concept to me.
Yeah. The actual physical raising of the dead is something that shows up in several different places, both in Western magical tradition, but I mean, even in the Bible. So it's something that I've wondered if it is indeed possible, though my sneaking suspicion is that something like a vampire, if it existed, was probably more spirit than it was like physically, you know, an actual dead person, like an actual, you know, dead body that like was running around.
Yeah, I mean, there's pretty clearly a vampire tradition in places like Eastern Europe and so forth, but might look at something like John Michael Greer's Monsters book, where he goes into detail about vampires being basically an individual who has been caught between the two deaths, you know, the death of the physical body and the death of the, or the dissolution of the etheric body. And that person has somehow learned to keep that ethereal, the etheric corpus together by grabbing energy from living people, which, you know, is very, I mean, Greer says it is extraordinarily rare now, given the way that we dispose of bodies, because you do need to have an intact body to come back to, apparently. But I found his discussion of that really, really interesting. And you know, something that you know could possibly be the case. You see something similar to that in Dion Fortune's semi-fictional Secrets of Dr. Taverner. She has a vampire story in there too. Very similar circumstance. So there's something there. But the point I'd like to make, Vincent, is that you know the Loa and demons are not the same thing.
Oh no, I'm not.
Yeah, you're.
Well,
you're
depends how you.
Well, I mean, depending on your religious perspective, yeah, I guess.
I would
but
put that up. No,
the folks that are involved in Vodal are you know obviously very attuned to their spirits, and you know I've known several people who were involved in the tradition, and you know to them being ridden by the Loa is a privilege. And it's not something that that they take on lightly. It's something that they prepare intensively for through a series of initiatic experiences. And you have to learn how to do it. You know, it's not you know something you just oh hey I think I'm going to get possessed by the Loa today. there's a whole ritual set involved in how that happens. So it's very different in my mind from the kind of demonic possession that I think you might be thinking about.
No, I accept that they're totally different things.
Yeah, yeah.
If I understand correctly, a lot of the Loa are spirits of the ancestors, and they're not fallen angels in the Bible. They're the spirits of the ancestors, and yes, it's seen as a very positive thing. I don't
There's
a negative light. No,
there's a whole sector of Vodun spirits called the Gede. I think that's how it's pronounced. I don't speak French, so which are the spirits of the dead. And when they come in, they're usually pretty raunchy, apparently. You know, they are very much about, you know, having a body and having a good time. Some of the higher Loa, Papa Legba, for instance, or Erzuli, some of the others.
Well, they're basically gods, right?
They're basically gods. Yeah. So if you're, you know, it's much like the kind of to a greater degree, much like the kind of invocatory magic that you see in, you know, religions like Wicca, for instance, or you see, you know, the calling of God forms into people in ceremonial magic too. So, you know, it's just a kind of a different way of doing that. And of course, Wren can talk more about that than I can, but it's certainly something that is a possibility. There is, though, in my mind, you know, a certain very rare type of spirit that is basically, you know, not pleased with humanity and, you know, exists to give us a hard time. I don't know that I particularly think of them as fallen angels because there have been stories about them since ancient Babylon. You know, and it does seem that some of those beings have a thing for human bodies. But I think that, as you say, the vast majority of people who are talking about demonic possessions are talking about mental illness. There's rare circumstances where there may actually be some spiritual action happening as well.
Who tends to get possessed tends to be kids who grew up in a really religious family. And you don't have to be, you know, a Freudian psychologist to see that maybe that's part of their own personality that resents the fundamentalist religion that's being forced upon them.
Sure.
But they can't, as themselves, say the things that the demon says. So mm-hmm. they develop a, like, second personality that just unloads on how much they hate all this religious crap. And that, to me, explains a lot of it without any actual demons.
Sure.
This is my take, you know?
And I would totally agree with that. There are certain psychoses, you know, certain mental illnesses that, you know, and, you know, as you say, that kind of split personality syndrome that could totally explain a lot of the things that we see.
I just wonder, do people from secular families who aren't religious ever get possessed? Does that ever happen? Because it seems like they're always from very religious families.
Yeah, I think that's I couldn't answer that one. Wren, do you know?
Well, I think that maybe more the religious families are able to correctly identify it. I think the inverse could also be true, in that you have cases of possession that because they, you know, exhibit themselves in a completely secular environment are just treated as mental illness. Right?
I had a friend who worked in mental health some time ago, who was also a esoteric person, and he called them demon traps. There were two. Dravite is a brown tourmaline. I think it comes from Australia. But he had these two large chunks of tourmaline next to his office door, one on each side of his office door, that he had programmed to remove negative energies, negative entities, parasites, whatever the hell they were dragging with them. And he said it was remarkable. He'd have these people who were just, you know, very disturbed come through his door and all of a sudden be almost completely normal. So there is something to that idea that there is a spiritual component to, say, mental illness, but that's not all of it either. I think that what you have is a syncretic effect, that, you know, the one exists and therefore the other exists or is drawn to it. So
it's also worth keeping in mind, too, that on some level, it seems like full on supernatural possession is not the most advantageous strategy for, let's say, like a predatory spirit. Ideally, like a good hacker, you would want to be inside of the system and not be detected, mm-hmm. right? Feeding off whatever you want to feed off of without anyone noticing you're there,
yeah.
right? And I think that can happen frequently. The dramatic possessions is just people just carrying along effectively parasites, right, that are just sort of leeching off of them.
That's something I hate about Hollywood, that if somebody's possessed by the devil, they always look, or is the offspring of the devil, they always look horrible and do all this disgusting stuff. If that really happened, they'd probably be beautiful and, you know, be very beguiling, because that would be a lot more effective.
You have to think, too, I mean, staying hidden would be of primary importance, because, frankly, exorcism isn't that difficult to do. You could do something like the headless rite that's like a potent exorcism, like assuming that you come into contact with someone who knows how to perform the exorcism. It's, you know, not that difficult to do. So you'd want to stay hidden if you were like some sort of spiritual predator.
Analogy's dead on, man.
Yeah. Well, my friend who was a mentor to me for quite some time, who was also quite psychic back in my much, much, much younger days, said that, you know, you're talking about parasites, Wren. Said one of the most common places to find parasites is bars, because you have people who are drinking to excess, who are basically damaging their auric field, which is the you know, the life force that surrounds you, basically.
Right.
And just providing open space for these predatory spirits, these parasites, really, that feed on, you know, depression and guilt and anger and all the things that you find in bars, you know, just provide open season for these things, you know, and they come and attach to alcoholic people. And, you know, alcoholic people tend to be depressive anyway. And so don't even notice that their energy is being sucked because they just feel like crap all the time anyway. So, yeah, it's an interesting it's an interesting study.
And that same entity could be subtly encouraging them to stay alcoholic as a way to keep their, you know, immune system effectively down and
exhausted.
Yeah. That's something that Josephine McCarthy, she wrote, I think it's The Exorcist's Handbook, I think. It's a really, really good book. Pretty breezy.
So who was that again, Ren?
Josephine McCarthy.
Oh, yeah.
And I read that recently, and that's something that she talks about as well, especially as an advice for exorcists. It's like, if you're going to be doing exorcism, you kind of need to quit drinking alcohol as just a defense mechanism for yourself.
Well, I noticed, you know, in my own life, many moons ago, you know, distinct improvement in my my native mental state after, you know, giving up alcohol. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I don't know whether to attribute that to the changes in brain biochemistry or spiritual or otherwise, but
maybe both.
It's definitely something to consider.
A lot of people like to poke fun at the spiritual element of Alcoholics Anonymous, but I honestly think that it's probably an advantageous thing to have in a program like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I understand that there are some, you know, secular humanist types who get really offended by all that stuff, but you know, the whole concept of a higher power is so flexible in AA that you know, I met people whose higher power was Ralph, you know, the porcelain god that they worshipped when they got, you know, got hammered for a while anyway. You know, for myself, I ended up it's basically what started me on you know, the esoteric journey. Such a spiritual journey. And I ended up coming in contact with just the right people that I needed to meet at the particular time I needed to meet them. And yeah, the rest, as they say, is history. But, you know, that need for a higher power was one of the things that, you know, got me going out into the, you know, into the mountains of around Arizona, around Phoenix, where I lived at the time. And, you know, spending some time, you know, chatting with whatever higher power was out there. I had no name for it at that time, but it was something that needed to happen.
Yeah, that's interesting. Wren, did you have any other comments about the whole, like, all the other stuff we talked about in the middle there?
I did want to mention, looping back around to the idea of vampires, that one thing I was super aware of until I started researching lycanthropy, like last year, was that a lot of werewolf mythology and folklore is almost impossible to distinguish from vampire folklore if you sort of remove the word, right? Like the description of what actually happens is very similar. But the other interesting element to that was that a lot of traditional werewolf folklore actually involved a person not physically transforming into a wolf, but rather effectively when they go to sleep at night, they create a wolf in the wilderness that runs around and does, you know, horrible things and kills sheep and eats people. But it's almost like a sort of out of body skinwalker idea, you know, that the werewolf is a functionally like spirit creature. And the other element too of the vampire thing is the whole idea of blood being important to human shades to regain some degree of corporeal form. You see that in like ancient Greek necromancy, where in order to conjure a shade and have a conversation with it, you have to make a sacrifice of blood to it. So usually like, you know, an ox or something. That's what Odysseus does in the Odyssey to speak to, I think, Tiresias. And in the Odyssey, he has to sort of beat off other spirits with his sword to give Tiresias the chance to drink enough of the sacrificial blood to take form. And I think that that idea goes back basically into antiquity, that that blood is some sort of powerful medium and maybe sort of a metaphorical reference to a sort of life force or something, but that these spiritual entities are able to feed on that and gain the ability to influence and interact with the gross world of matter through that.
Hmm. All right.
Yeah, I mean, talking about the shapeshifters and the whole doing it while you're asleep, there's a story in Norse mythology about a fella who, Bogvi Bjarki or something along that line, I can't remember the exact name, but who was one of the primary warriors for his king. And when his king went into battle, this huge bear would manifest and just wreak havoc on the enemy ranks. And one of the other guys that was in this battle went running back to the village because they didn't see this Bjarki fellow, right? Mm-hmm. Went running back to the village and found him asleep in his home, right? So wake him up. He wakes him up. He's like, you've got to come. We're in this big battle. And he's like, I was there already. You know? And as soon as they woke him up, the bear disappeared. So not only did you have this person creating a bear form in a trance or sleep state, but the thing had physical effect in this world. Mm-hmm. You know, so you're talking about that whole idea of conjuration, bringing something to physical manifestation and, the idea of, you know, Sasquatch or whatever coming across and decaying and smelling like sulfur. There you go. I wonder what the bear smelled like. Yeah. But well, there were a lot of Vikings that found out the hard way what that bear smelled like.
I just had a recent conversation with a guy named Clay Van Diver, and he was talking about werewolf mythology. And in there was a similar, very similar concept. That you don't create a wolf, but you come out of your body and you possess a wolf, like an actual wolf, but you take over its body and you do what you want to do. And then you return to your own body. And that seemed quite fascinating. And there was like a real wolf, like it was a regular wolf minding its own business. And you take control of its body and run amok and then go back to your own body. And that was the one interpretation of the werewolf belief system.
Yeah. Well, there are certainly people in the modern witchcraft community that believe that they can actually ride along with an animal. I don't know if they go so far as to, make the animal do stuff. But, you know, it's still a thing in modern magical lore.
All right. Sort of wonder the mechanisms of that. Like, I wonder if people have ever tried doing that with like an octopus or something. Something is completely different from human experience, right? Or some animal that has, you know, eyes that face in different directions. Like, what does that even look like?
True.
Yeah, I know that most of the folks that I've read about have been doing mammalian species, but this is a castaneda. I think it's Castaneda who, and again, big question mark on that one. But there is the description of him shapeshifting into a raven and can't figure out what the hell is going on because his vision's just gone completely wonky and it's going in two directions. Mm-hmm. And I imagine that's kind of how it would be if you tried to do something like an octopus or, even, you know, like a bovine that has eyes that set more to the sides, deer or whatever.
But not only that, but other animals see differently.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Yeah.
At the same time, it makes a lot more sense to me that you would, your soul or whatever, come your ethereal body or what have you, whatever comes out of your body and takes over the body of an animal, that makes a lot more sense than actually shapeshifting.
True.
Which would be so difficult to imagine the physics involved there. Like, where's the hair come from? You know, how do you change this into that? That doesn't really work.
Yeah, reality. The power outlay for that would be just ridiculous.
But if reality is an illusion, you know,
True. Well, but that was the thing I noticed a lot in the folklore was that actual stories of actual shape-shifting, like the person physically becoming an animal or whatever, were very rare comparatively. Mm-hmm. Almost all the stories were the person was in a trance state and a wolf appeared somewhere and that they're connected to it somehow, but that, yeah, they don't physically become the animal.
That probably comes more from the Universal monster movies, I'm guessing.
Well, no, actually, going back to Norse mythology again, you actually do have Siegfried and his son, I believe, who get into a fight with a couple of bandits and kill them. And these two guys have these wolf belts. And when you put the belt on, you change into a wolf. And this was also a common staple in some of the werewolf trials and so forth later on in the Middle Ages, where you know, Satan or the devil or whoever it is that these people are supposed to have gotten this power from, or is supposed to have given them some kind of a token that they put on that, you know, caused the physical transformation. Now, again, you know, are they actually physically transforming, or do they have a perception of having physically transformed? Mm. Yeah, that is the question.
I was reading something a while back in 14 Times, the UK publication, and they were talking about, oh God, I want to say medieval, but I think it was the 1500s. I'm not sure if that's medieval or Renaissance, but this guy who was put on trial for being a werewolf. But he was like God's werewolf, and he like fought evil spirits and stuff.
He's one of the Ben and Dotti.
You're familiar with this then?
Oh yeah.
Because that was a mind blower for me. I hadn't heard of that before.
Yeah, that's an incredible trial transcript. I've read that as well, and it's pretty amazing.
Yes, indeed.
Please. I've never.
I read one article. You guys know about this. Go ahead.
Well, I think. Probably between Wren and I, we've probably read a lot of really weird stuff. I'm trying to remember the name of the book. There's a whole book that revolves around that particular trial. It's Carlo Ginzburg and it's Night Something. Wren, do you know what I'm talking about?
No, I've read that one. I read about the case in the Claude Lescaut's Mysteries of the Werewolf. I think.
Oh, okay. Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. Know that one too.
But yeah, that story's amazing because he's, you know, he's like, I was doing God's work for him as, I forget, was he like trying to do it so he could get into heaven or something? It's been a while since I read the actual story.
The one that I'm thinking of, they go out on a semi-regular basis, like twice a year, and they have to battle the bad werewolves and, in order to be sure that the harvest is night battles. It was called night battles.
Mm, yeah.
So the idea was, you know, as I said, that these Ben and Dotti, these good werewolves, the God's werewolves were actually doing this battle against the evil, the Malandotti, I forget what they're called now, and they go into battle with like, reeds or something, and they would fight and drive these guys off to ensure good harvest and to be sure that, you know, the village didn't starve and so forth. But he was very upfront about it in the trial. Yeah. It's like, yeah, I do this. You know, twice a year I go and assume my wolf form and go off and do this thing. You know?
Wow.
Yeah, I remember it having a sort of resonance with some of the stuff that Michael Berdio talks about. I think it's in I think it's in Outer Gateways, Kenneth Grant's Outer Gateways, or maybe it's Seconds Fountain. I can't remember now, but there's a part where he talks about Berdio and the idea of Berdio's Mystery of the Werewolf, about how in order for the magician to fight monsters, like this idea that they're, you know, these entities from the Klipot, who are sort of these trans-Saturnian monsters from beyond darkest Yuggoth, in order to do battle with them, the magician has to become a monster too, and specifically like a werewolf in order to fight against them. And when I read that account, I was like, oh, this is just like what Berdio is talking about. You know, Berdio is talking about it in sort of this modern ceremonial magic context, but it's kind of the same idea.
Yeah.
And it was like, it's something that, you know, I think I've talked to on this show about my experience several times through my life where I would have an out of body experience or and be confronted or attacked by something and, you know, become a werewolf to fight back against it. It was like the first time I remember this happening was when I was a little kid, and me and my brother used to sleep in bunk beds, and I was on the top bunk, and I woke up one night. And, you know, again, I don't know if this was a dream or this really happened or what the deal was, but I assume it was a dream or not a body experience. But I woke up, he was crying, and I lean over the side of the bed, and there's like classic gray alien, like standing over him, like staring at him. And he's like upset and crying. And I felt my child body like grow claws and hair, and like I was turning into a little werewolf. And I jumped off the bed onto it and started just like clawing at its face and like peeled off one of its eyes like a big sticker. And like inside of its head was like a star field. And I think that like shocked me awake at that point. But I had another experience several years ago now where I had a hag-riding experience where I felt something get into bed with me. I was paralyzed and unable to move. And I stood up, but I went out of body when I stood up and then had something jump on my back and ride me around the room. And when I was finally able to throw it off of me, I, in this, you know, out of body dream-like state, felt myself become like a werewolf. And I like ate the thing that had been on my back, just like devoured it.
I love that one.
Yeah, it's cool. It's like, you know, it's, I remember that happening. And then I ended up reading that line of Kenneth Grant talking about Bertio's, you know, the magician must become the monster thing like a week later. And it like freaking me out pretty badly.
That's that like a little synchronicity to make your day, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The thing with Grant, of course, is that he throws in so much of the Lovecraft stuff, and it almost becomes fantasy after a while.
Reading his stuff has a certain quality to it. Just kind of makes you feel like you're going crazy.
Hey, since you guys have heard of that, have you heard of the Eastern Orthodox saint who was a dog-headed man?
Yeah, Saint Christopher was supposed to be a son, kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah, Christopher.
Yeah. Yeah. And that just seems to hang out there like, yeah, that's cool, that happens.
Apparently the legend was that he came from an emissary from a whole island full of these folks, so and they were very blasé about it. It's like, okay, yeah, whatever, dog-headed people.
Think that happens. Yeah, like, oh yeah, that's normal. No, it's not normal. What?
Yeah, I was reading, like I said, I've been reading Aaron Deese's Texas Dogman Triangle, and I was like, dude, I know these places. I mean, he's talking about Medina Lake. I actually lived there at one point, not 4 or 5 miles from the lake, just down Park Road 37, which I think he references too. And there were stories and along the Pernalis River and places that I've actually been. So it was kind of old home week for me.
What book is this?
It's Aaron Deese. He just published it. It's a Small Town Monsters publication, Texas Dogman Triangle. They made a movie out of it too. Small Town Monsters made a movie out of it too. Documentary.
Okay.
So
yeah, I'm not familiar with that one.
Yeah. No, I mean, when you think Dogman, you think Linda Godfrey, right? But
sure.
Yeah, since she's passed, you know, there hasn't been a whole lot of Dogman stuff going on. But he just wrote this book about a series of sightings that happened in my old stomping grounds in Texas. So he talks about Fredericksburg, for instance, which is a place I used to go to, a state park just past Fredericksburg called Enchanted Rock. I spent a lot of time there. Haunted as hell. it was a battle site. So it was a residual haunting place, kind of like a lot of what happens with Gettysburg. I've sat on the side of Enchanted Rock in the full moon and had some really interesting experiences. So.
Well, we got to take a quick break. We will be right back.
Okay.
All right. Quick mid-show break here and a recommendation. So first of all, anything you need, Where Did the Road Go related, can be found at wheredidtheroadgo.com. all the shows back to the very first one, all the social media links, emails, etc. If you have a story you want to share, the link is on there, but you can email stories at wheredidtheroadgo.com. If you're into heavier music, especially if you want to check out stuff you're not going to hear elsewhere, you can check out my music show, The Last Exit for the Lost, and that is at thelastexit.org. There's a weekly show plus archives that go way, way back. Lots of stuff there, more than you'll probably ever be able to listen to, honestly. But that's another weekly show, but it is mostly music with breaks where we talk about interesting stuff in between. All right, recommendations. I'm going to go with another Pacific Northwest Stories podcast called Rabbits. And I think there's two seasons, and there might be, I believe there's a book. I haven't read the book. So the first season is very good. The second season, if I remember right, was also pretty good. I think they're both sort of self-contained to some degree. It's been a while since I listened to them, but they're easily as good as Tanis or the Black Tapes, which I've talked about previously. And I feel like there's more of an ending to them. It's a very weird concept. It's sort of an augmented reality game type of thing. I don't really want to talk too much about it because it'll give it away. So, if you like, if you want to listen to a weird story, check out Rabbits. And again, that's Pacific Northwest Stories or something like that. Pacific Northwest something. And it's kind of cool. So there you go. Rabbits is my recommendation this week. And now, back to the show. You're listening to Where Did the Road Go? And I have Wren and Vincent Treewell and Travis Watson. And Travis, you said you had weird experiences at that rock?
Yeah, it was, I'm not clairvoyant, so I don't see things, but you certainly have the experience in that place of the energies moving around you. And a lot of, you can almost hear the battle that happened at that particular spot. I'd like to say, oh, yes, there were ghosts everywhere. They were running all around. It's like, but I would be lying if I said that. So, but yeah, there's definitely a very strong energetic field in that place. And there's a lot of residual, what people would call residual ghost energies are left behind from that battle. It's kind of a giant stone tape. It's a giant granite dome. It's an old volcanic dome.
Huh. One of the regrets in my life is not meeting with Linda Godfrey while she was alive. She really, did a lot of Beast of Bray Road, Dogman things. There is a woman on the internet named Bettina Moss from Alabama who has done a lot of Dogman research, like a ton of it. Okay. And she's mostly on Facebook and YouTube. But and I'm not a co-signer. She speaks for herself. But she has some very interesting things out there.
Cool. I'll have to look her up.
And what do you guys think of Dogman? Because unlike Sasquatch, which you could say, well, this creature could exist, Dogman doesn't seem like something that should naturally exist.
No, I have kind of the same, a lot of the same feelings about Dogman that I have about Sasquatch. It's like, except that I'm very doubtful that there's actually a physical, organic entity that is the cause of some of these sightings. Because, we see Dogman appearing in people's bedrooms. Godfrey describes, there being the shaggy type that lives outdoors and eats roadkill and stuff like that. And then there are the ones that appear in your bedroom that bear a remarkable resemblance to Anubis. I have to believe that there's some kind of either people are responding to, geomagnetic energies and they're having visions of something, or, it's a spiritual entity from the other side that comes through occasionally and manifests physically. I can't see Dogman being an actual thing, like an actual animal. I suppose it's possible that there are a few dogs that have, it's one of the things that Deese talks about in this book is, and I think that's how he pronounced his name. I don't know for sure. It's spelled D-E-E-S-E. So one of the things he talks about is that, you know, his wife, I think, is a vet tech, and he talked to somebody who is a veterinary person that describes dogs being able to, you know, assume a bipedal position if they're injured and unable to use those front paws. The thing is, though, that their hips degenerate rapidly after doing that. So, you know, I suppose it's possible that some people are seeing an actual dog that has assumed, you know, a bipedal stance because of injury or whatever, dog or wolf or coyote or something like that because of an injury. But I've got to think that that's the exception to the rule. You have one of the things that stands out in dogman, or two of the things that stand out in dogman sightings are, you know, you have the silence that develops when these creatures are present. And this is something that goes to like Jenny Randall's the Oz effect, right? Where ambient noise just fades away when this, you know, this creature manifests itself. The other thing is the reaction that people have to this thing is almost universally terror. You know, it's not even like Sasquatch where you have some people that, you know, have like it's a Sasquatch in the woods kind of encounter where other people have very terrifying encounters. Almost universally with the dog man, I know of one person who's had a dog man encounter that didn't find the creature terrifying. And in the book that I just got finished reading, everybody had the terror effect except for one person who was kind of blasé about it. That to me is also a sign that, you know, you're experiencing an energy that doesn't resonate well with the human energy field, that produces that terror effect. I got to think that the dogmen are more of a spiritual entity or, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, you can't even say it's the ghost of something because nothing like that's ever existed.
Right. You
know? Unlike Sasquatch, which resembles great apes, resembles primates that we know exist, dogmen could not evolve. It wouldn't work like that. And it's usually described as having not like the body of a injured dog, but having a massive human body that's usually heavily muscled and like very tall and very strong looking and a canine head. Well, that doesn't evolve. Yeah. That can't even be genetically created. That doesn't. No, I get what you're saying. It doesn't work as a natural animal.
No, it really doesn't. The only reason I brought up the injury thing is because it's possible that some people
would see something
that just weirded them out and they're like, holy crap, what is that? And you know, in their minds, it got a lot bigger than it was. It happens. You know?
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, the people who are seeing these Anubis style, you know, dogmen with the smooth black coats and stuff, it's like, no, I'm sorry. That's not something you're going to develop naturally.
Right.
That came from somewhere else.
some people have linked it to the Native American Mounds. And that they seem to be guardians thereof. I mean, that's one theory that floats around out there.
Well, it's certainly possible. I mean, you know, Wren can certainly talk about the creation of, you know, some people call them servitors, you know, just a thought form. I hate the word tulpa because, you know, it's actually a Tibetan word that refers to a very specific style of development and meditation. But Western magic has its thought forms and these things can be created and, you know, can take particular forms, and I'll let Wren take it from there.
I mean, you can make a ghost. Theoretically you could make something like that occur. But I mean, I also, this is going to sound very skeptical of me, and I don't think this is the case all the time, but isn't it also possible, too, that these are costumes? It doesn't seem particularly difficult for somebody to make a costume in a place that's dark already. It wouldn't be too difficult to make it look legitimate. Has anybody ever brought up that possibility that some of these might?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's sure one of the that things that happened.
It's one of the things that Linda Godfrey talks about in her books is that, there is probably a a certain percentage of these sightings, particularly night sightings, that are, you know, some joker in a costume who's having a good time with somebody. Where you run into trouble with that theory, though, is, you know, people seeing these things in broad daylight. The descriptions that people make of the way these creatures move, it's not something that a human being can do. You know, because they're described as having legs, sometimes having legs like a dog.
With reversed hacks
and hackles, or whatever they call those things, hocks. I can't think of the word right now. I'm sure that some joker has gone out and scared the crap out of somebody and created a dogman sighting, around Halloween or whatever. Yeah. I think that there's enough... If you read the corpus of Linda Godfrey's work, there's so many of these freaking sightings that can't just be hoaxers.
It is interesting that the hoax angle, because I think about that a lot, because near where I grew up, there was a pretty famous cryptid hoax called the Chocolaca Monster.
Oh, yeah.
Are you familiar with the Chocolaca Monster?
I've heard of it. I'm not bringing it. Yeah, go for it.
It was just a guy with a cow skull and like a fur coat or something. It was like some kind of like robe. And he was like jumping out at people on this sort of like rural dirt road that runs by this creek near where I grew up. And he stopped doing it when people started forming hunting parties. And
Shoot. I was going to say, where I come from, if you did something like that, you might get plugged.
Yeah, this is in Alabama. So he was taking a big risk doing it.
Yeah.
And he finally came clean and said, no, that was just me. I was just messing around. But there's one lady who had, you know, a sighting of this, who I assume, you know, he was the thing that she saw, but she described it as like swooping down out of the air at her and everything. Oh. Like this sort of dramatic story that she told and that she sticks to this day. I don't know if she's still alive, but it was something that could not have been possible for him to do. But in her mind, at least the way she perceived that experience, it was far more supernatural than you know, what should have occurred if it was just him standing by the road and like jumping out and scaring people.
And there you have that whole idea of the thought form, something being formed by, you know, by all of the imagination and visualization and emotional energy that, you know, it's entirely possible that she saw the Chocolaca Monster that had been created by all of this, all of these people getting stirred up about this thing.
That's
right?
What I was going to say.
Yeah. It's Slender Man all over again.
Yeah.
Reminds me of Jim like Moseley and doing completely fake UFO stuff and then generating people that see your actual UFOs.
Yeah, that's what I was going to reference, was that story that Alan told me about Mosley calling up this sheriff's department being like, yeah, there's this giant flying saucer over the dam. And the next day in the newspaper, there being a story about it where there were multiple eyewitness reports from people who were actually at the dam of a flying saucer being over the dam.
Yeah. You know, crop circles where you have people who are faking them, and then you have things that are going like, wait a minute, how did that happen? You know, you have people actually there when the thing forms and start to see the outline occurring and stuff. So, and there's no human agency there. So
this is like something that I think magicians and occultists get more than most people. Because anyone who's done like ceremonial magic or in the Western magical tradition, but I'm sure in others, there is an element of like LARPing to it, you know?
Oh, yeah.
I wear an outfit. I have all these like funny tools in this like temple with all these like candles and stuff. Like, you know, it's like a whole dramatic production that you put on.
Fake it until you make it.
Yeah. And faking it to make it, basically.
Like, yeah.
You're getting so into this that, like you said, you generate the thought form through basically like telling a story. I don't know. It reminds me of I've like incorporated Archive 81 stuff into my own personal cosmology of really? How this stuff works. Yeah, because like the idea that, because it was funny, I actually ran across this in Agrippa. I think it's in book 2 where he's talking about the construction of ritual and how it's important. Like, let's say you're doing a ritual for like a lunar mansion or something. You're supposed to, there's like this whole, like an example is in the Picatrix, but you could create these on your own. But the Orphic Hymns are like an example of this, where you tell the story of the entity or the planet or whatever. Like you talk about the moon, you talk about all of the moon's different names. You talk about the moon's qualities. You talk about mythological cycles involving the moon. And it's almost like that act of storytelling, like these entities are in some sense made of story, like that story is what like powers them in some sense. And that imaginal energy generated by storytelling is what they subsist on or sometimes composed of.
That's interesting.
Yeah. I've been running with that idea recently and going to talk more about it at some point, but it's still sort of rattling around in my brain.
When I was playing Eternal Darkness years ago on the GameCube, they had a bunch of sigils and stuff in that game, and I started using a couple of them just to see if it would do anything, and I had absolutely no results from it.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, I'm actually working right now on a personal grimoire that exists solely on audio cassette tapes. I'm like recording on cassette tapes.
Nice. So
like list of spells and records of experiments and stuff. So I'm basically just going to recreate season 3 of Archive 81.
Okay, what is an Archive 81? Have I missed something here?
It's a really terrible Netflix show, but an incredible podcast that came out before the Netflix show. Everybody's like, if you look up anything about it, you're going to find stuff about the Netflix show. But the podcast is what I'm referring to. And it's like one of my, it's like a fiction podcast. So it's,
but it's brilliant.
Like radio. Yeah, it's, Soraya introduced me to it. And I was actually re-listening to it recently. And it's just, it's amazing. It's really, really good. And especially hits if you're into magic or the occult, because there's like so many little things that sync up with the actual experience of doing magic.
And the funny thing is the people who create it are not into that stuff.
Yeah, they say that. They say that publicly, but there's also things that they talk about that you would only know if you were really into this stuff.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Yeah. I didn't hate the TV show.
I hated it. I think it's god awful.
I enjoyed it. It doesn't come close to the podcast, but
I didn't even finish it because I got so frustrated by all the James Wan like weird Christian stuff that he was like shoehorning into it. All the like Catholic guilt stuff.
True.
And I was like, oh come on, like this is like so far removed from what the podcast is trying to do that it just frustrated me.
Yeah, the podcast has 3 seasons that are all entirely different.
Yeah, they're very different from each other.
So, and I thought they were going to do another season, but it sounds like now they're just done.
That sucks. Well, I guess there was the Left of the Dial. There's like a sort of a short
mini
radio
one, yeah. Well, there's many seasons in between I think all the seasons, if I remember right.
Yeah, they're sort of like smaller mini ones.
Yeah,
that sucks if they're not going to do a season 4 though, because like, I mean, I guess it didn't really end on a cliffhanger or anything. I mean, all those plot threads get kind of wrapped up. It's not like there's anything left hanging, but that's just unfortunate.
But you know, it got the podcast numbers went through the roof when the TV show came out.
Yeah,
and so you would think you would want to capitalize on that by doing another season.
You know, one of the things about the TV show I think that frustrates me the most is I was like looking up things about people who watched or listened to the podcast after watching the TV show first. And they were like, oh, this podcast is so boring. It's so amateurish. Like,
really?
Nothing. Yeah. People were like, people who seemed to really enjoy the TV show were like absolutely hated the podcast.
Huh.
Which is completely opposite of my opinions on this.
Well, maybe it's like that. I mean, like someone will be like, oh, such and such is my favorite album by a band. And it's like their worst record. And then you're like, why? Why that one? And they're like, because it's the first one I heard.
Yeah.
So, you know, to people who watch the TV show first, that's Archive 81 and they enjoyed it. And then they go to listen to the weirdness that is the podcast. And they're like, yeah, I don't get it. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. This isn't what I remember. Yeah. It's unfortunate, but yeah, Travis, definitely. If you enjoy like radio play fiction podcast type stuff, I can't recommend Archive.
Really weird fiction.
Yeah.
Really weird fiction. Okay. I'll have to check that out.
Weird fiction with very
in
good
my
use
copious
of,
spare time.
Weird fiction with really good use of audio.
Mm. Yeah.
They use audio in some really creative ways and the concepts in the show are just fantastic. Like first season's good and then it gets great.
Yeah. The first season's pretty short, too. I mean, you could literally listen to it in a single day. It's maybe 4 hours total.
So, and then the second season, the episodes get longer.
Yeah.
I almost didn't listen to the second season. I started it and I'm like, wow, I think this is too weird. I don't know if I want to listen to it. And I left it for a while and then came back to it and was like, oh no, this is awesome. Why didn't I like this before?
Yeah. I had the exact same experience. It took me a while. I started the second season and I was like, God, this is so totally different than the first.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I enjoy this. And I came back maybe 6 months later and started it again. And I was like, oh no, actually this is awesome. So and I think you need like kind of a break between the first and second, you know, you kind of have to give yourself a little break.
And I feel like, it might be one of the only fiction podcasts I've listened to more than once.
Yeah, same for me too. Yep.
I listened to it going down to see Tim in PA at one point. Listened to it straight through all the way down, and by the time I got there, I just felt weird. It's like, what did that just do to my brain after listening to it for 4.5 hours straight?
Yep.
Good fiction will do that to you.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And again, they do a lot with audio too, which plays into, it's an audio format, but I can't believe people said it was amateurish.
Well, I mean, going back and listening to the first season recently, it is rough around the edges, but that's because it has like literally zero budget. Yeah. You know, it's just like it is an amateur project. At least it was at the start. I think they maybe had the Patreon going by the second season and could actually maybe have a bit more of a budget to work with. But even so, like, I don't know. All the changes in the TV show, like making Melody, like straight washing Melody.
Right, right.
Like shoehorning in some kind of weird Dan Melody, like romance angle.
Yeah, yeah. I
really like, oh God, this is awful.
Well, you gotta have that in there somewhere.
Time travel into it. It was just like, oh my God.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious where they meant to go with the second season. Because obviously, I mean, my thing was, how are you going to do the second season in a video format? And then it looks like they weren't even going to go there. They were just going to do something completely different.
Yeah, if you were going to adapt any of them, you'd have to adapt the third, because the third season's the only one that maybe is a little more adaptable.
Yeah, because the second one takes place in an other world.
Yeah, yeah. That's frequently described as indescribable. So yeah,
right.
It doesn't really work visually. Now that we've talked about this thing that only me and Soraya know about. Sorry to leave you guys out of that.
No, I've actually seen the Netflix version. I didn't follow through on it, but I've got to check out the... I'm familiar with it. I just haven't listened to the podcast, but I probably have to do that.
Oh, you definitely have to do that.
I've spent too much time under a rock lately.
With the poltergeists?
With the poltergeists and ghosts and apparitions and Sasquatches and... I have a lot of company under my rock.
So when are you aiming to get your book done by? Do you have a set idea?
It's due November.
Oh,
so,
okay.
Yeah. So I'm still slogging along. But the thing is, once you get that first draft done, you know, after that, it's basically taking the emery boards to it.
Yeah.
At least for me. I know some people do major revisions in their second run through, but it's like, A, usually I don't have time to do that. And B, things come together pretty well. So,
yeah. All right. Good. We're almost out of time here. Travis, where can people find all your books?
Oh, Amazon. Look at the great Amazon machine. Because all of my books are available both as Kindle paperback. And for those of you who have Kindle Unlimited, they're all available in Kindle Unlimited. So it's such a deal.
and it's under W.T. Watson.
That's correct. Yeah, I write under W.T. Watson, but everybody who knows me calls me Travis. So.
And Wren, where can people find you?
So people can find me at liminalroom.com. I have a blog there that has links to social media stuff as well as my Discord server. So if people want to chat with me on Discord, they can reach me through there. I believe it's also got my email address too. So if you want to send me an email, we can also chat that way.
All right. And Vincent, you have both a book and a podcast.
That is correct. Yes. Thank you. The book is Cosmic Collision. It is a novel. It's available on Amazon as a Kindle or paperback. My main website is vincenttreewell.wordpress.com.
Did you almost say GeoCities?
No. Oh, okay. I almost said Gmail because my email is vincenttreewell@gmail.com. GeoCities, a little back in time.
Yes, me. Just a little.
No, it's vincenttreewell.wordpress.com. And yes, vincenttreewell@gmail.com if you want to email me.
Okay.
And I'm on Facebook.
And the name of your podcast?
That is The Weird Part with Vincent Treewell.
All right. And you also do awesome recaps for this show.
Thank you very much. Hey, my pleasure.
Which both I and everyone else appreciate, as far as I can tell.
Thanks a bunch.
This one's going to be fun to recap.
Yeah. All right. Thank all of you.
Yeah, thanks. More than welcome. Thanks so much.
More than welcome. Happy to be here.
I want to give a big thank you here to everyone who supports this show by becoming a Patreon. And I want to give a special shout out to those of you pledging $10 or more. Billuminati, Greg Ross, Leanne Cherry, Matt in Delaware, Allison Cook, Super Inframan, 36 Dingo, Matthew Sproul, Andrew Nichols, Christine, a blue second gen MR2 drifting around a Japanese mountain, Patricia Gaia Quinta, Alex Whitcomb, American Rambler, Andrew Maines, Ann Witowski, Barbara Fisher, Beverly Williamson, Big Boy Limina, Charles Davis, Charles in Florida, Land of the Crazy and Communicable, Chris Cicernos, Craig Parmenter, Diane B., Empty K., Eric Todd, History and Coffee, J. Otto Bullitt, Jack Huntington, James Lindsay, Jim and Sophie, John Mattingly, John Bracken, Carla Mahoney, Kevin Schreck, Cool Kitty, Kristen L., Laser Printer Jam, Lauren McLean, Linda, Linz Jackson K., Luke Osborne, MJ Armstrong, Mark Brady, Mr. Weird, Schmooples, Devourer of Mortal Souls, Ole Andre Olar, Paul Jeffries, Philosopher of Mirrors, Riker and Stark, Ron Dupre, Sam Sharon, Seed Person 1, Stacy Sherwood, Tactical Therapist, Taylor Bell, Thunderboy, Tyler Glimstead, Varosh K., Vincent Treewell, Will Gebhard, Will Powell, Wren Collier, Annabelle Smith, Caroline Walker, TDT, Skunkworks, and Craig Sagastumi. Thank you all so very, very much for helping make this show possible. There will be a short Patreon segment from this conversation. Kind of informal at that, because we just ended up talking about a bunch of stuff, and I realized, hey, this actually would make for a good Patreon segment. So that'll be up later in the week for anyone who's a patron. If you want to become a patron, just go to wheredidtheroadgo.com and click on the big Patreon link, and it's only $3 a month, and you get extra content almost every week, sometimes more than once a week, and you get the shows a week early, and it really helps us out immensely. And I want to welcome a new patron this week, Daniela Scafati. Welcome. And one thing I do want to say is that Patreon charges the first of every month. So if you're thinking about becoming a patron, wait till after the first, because if you sign up at the end of the month, you get charged twice. Just a heads up on that one. All right, I'm going to take you out tonight with a band from Rochester. I believe I played one of their live tracks before from our studio. Our performance studio for The Last Exit for the Lost. And again, if you like heavy music, www.thelastexit.org to check out my music show. But we're going to hear Hyshin. This is a band from Rochester. They have only an EP out that came out in 2021. And we're going to hear Ocean from that. They are working on a full length, I believe, that will be out before the end of the year. So, yes, Hyshin, and I will see you all next time. We'll be right back.
foam washes. There is no horizon. The sun sets on an empty sea. In the fleeting last rays of the winter sunlight, I have a momentary relapse. I am crying on my knees in the sand, and everything finally makes sense. It's over. The moment is gone, and the sunlight.
Have been listening to Where Did the Road Go? This show is made possible in part from our Patreons, and we thank you and everyone listening for helping us continue this exploration of the strange. You can always find everything Where Did the Road Go related at www.wheredidtheroadgo.com, and thank you so much for your support.